If you put older bipolar patients on lithium, you reduce their future dementia risk by 49%. Do you have any other drug that you use that reduces dementia risk by 50%? No, you don't. Now, again, they're a high-risk population, not a normal population, but you reduce their risk by 49%. Why would a severely obese 35-year-old man taking 1,200 milligrams of lithium still have a serum level of 0.4? Is it the volume of distribution? It may be, in fact, that he's 35 years old and it has nothing to do with his weight, because the GFR formula does not use weight. It's just that he has super-duper renal function. So assuming he's consistently 0.4, so you say he's not non-adherent, the issue is, and I bet if I looked up his GFR, I bet it's 109. So this is a guy who's just clearing lithium because he has great renal function. And you know how you solve that problem? Give him more. That's it. But you have to anticipate this. I treat a lot of younger adults with some first episode programs in San Diego. Their GFR is 110. You go, oh, the lithium level's low. Well, I mean, what did you expect? They're going to clear lithium much faster than an older adult with a GFR of 62. You stated we should never have lithium levels above 1.0. Is this true for inpatients? For inpatient, in that one chart, I said you can go up to 1.2, but really you want to do this for the shortest amount of time because you're not going to be able to keep them there. So in this day and age, as you know, if you're acutely manic, the first drug you're probably going to get is not going to be lithium. It's going to be what? An antipsychotic. Sometimes at the end of a needle, occasionally, often. So the lithium will be added to help out the atypical. In the long run, though, it's the lithium that's going to keep them stable. People on antipsychotic monotherapy who have a history of mania tend to do very poorly. They have to be mood stabilized. Yes, the antipsychotic is better than nothing, but it's not as good as lithium. And I'll give you a good statement, which is from a very famous author who wrote a lot of the early lithium studies, Moen Skou, who's a Danish psychiatrist. He said a patient who had been on lithium, who was manic, said, when you gave me the antipsychotic, it was like my foot was on the gas and the brake at the same time. When you gave me the lithium, it was like you turned the engine off. And that shows you the differences. Yes, they all have antimanic properties, lithium and antipsychotics, but they do very different things. The point being is, don't max out the lithium, give them really high levels just to make them better. At some point, you have to say, one mood stabilizer is not enough. If they're already on an atypical, I may have to add a second mood stabilizer. So here's a question. It says, it looked like in that one analysis, which showed that once daily lithium dosing is better for your kidneys. You got to go back. I didn't finish reading the question. So it looked like, I think, SSRI and SNRI use was associated with a lower risk of renal insufficiency. Why would that be? I think the best answer is it may be the kind of people who are getting SSRIs and SNRIs, meaning they might have been a higher functioning, that was interesting, it might have been a higher functioning group of individuals who maybe were taking lithium at lower rates, you know, maybe had better medical care. Because I don't think SSRIs are protective against renal insufficiency. So their problem was, again, some confounding bias, but which favored, actually, better medical care and lower risk of renal insufficiency. It's just a hypothesis, because there's no other explanation, because we don't think those drugs are protective for renal disease. Okay, next question. What's the most we can give of lithium at bedtime? Is it purely level related? It's actually not level related. You know what the limiting factor tends to be when you pile a bunch of lithium all at once? It's GI side effects. So there's two types of GI side effects. Since we have a little bit of time, I'll just kind of describe them to you. Number one, nausea. It means you're absorbing it in the jejunum too far up. If you can kind of slow that down with a sustained release preparation, that can help. If they're already on a sustained release preparation, you have them take it with food, which means with dinner. Just once a day, but with dinner instead of at bedtime. Food solves that problem. What if they're complaining about diarrhea? It means the ion is being delivered too far south, okay? How do you make that better? Well, if they're on a sustained release preparation, guess what? You go back to regular lithium. You move the absorption further north. If they're on regular lithium, you know how to solve that problem? You also have them take it with dinner. So that tends to become the rate limiting step when you start piling on lithium more and more. Now, admittedly, if the person needs a large dose, eventually you may have to split it up, but you just keep that morning dose to the bare minimum so it doesn't distort the level. Now, the question that was put in, I don't know who did it, they said the person was on 900 BID. So their job, of course, is to consolidate it. Now, the person may not tolerate it, so you may not do it all at once. But you want to try to get most of that to the evening, really, to kind of minimize the renal adverse effects. You just do what you can. You know, at some point, you may get to a point where they can only tolerate so much. This is probably, again, somebody with super-duper renal function, probably a younger adult, and they're just clearing the lithium rapidly, and it happens. Next question. The same question. Can you give 800 milligrams of lithium all at once? If they tolerate it, sure. If they don't, again, find out why they're not tolerating it. Maybe have them take it with dinner. If that doesn't work, you may have to give some of it in the morning, like 300. In our country, lithium carbonate is only available as 450 sustained release. Yeah, it doesn't matter if you give sustained release, as long as you give it, what? Once a day at bedtime. That is it. Sustained release, all it does is just maybe minimize some of the nausea. Half-life in your brain, it's the same, 28 to 48 hours. To patients who are not exercising, limit salt. You know, within the limits that most people ingest in Western society, it's usually not a big deal. Yes, I guess if they're binging on salt, maybe it's an issue, but I really don't get into that too much with lithium-treated patients about their salt intake. The only time I emphasize salt, and I don't know if you know this, most people in Western society get enough salt. See, you learned something. But again, you're going to exercise out and it's 105 outside. I want you not to drink water. I want you to drink Pedialyte. And even then, maybe take salt tablets. And again, if you're throwing up, if you have diarrhea, you're going to replace yourself with Pedialyte, not water. Next question. Lithium and lictal are often used together and are excreted through the kidneys. Is there an ideal lithium level with this combination? It's independent. Doesn't matter. Use whatever lithium they need. Why would I combine lamotrigine with lithium? As you know, I like lithium quite a bit. It does have anti-suicide properties, but it's not a great acute antidepressant. So if I had somebody who was bipolar 1, you say, look, I have this guy on Depakote, and he's depressed. Should I add lithium? I would say not for that reason. It's not an acute antidepressant. We have other medicines for bipolar depression, which you probably heard about today or you'll hear about tomorrow. Lamotrigine, its niche is preventing depressive relapse. You don't have to worry about the lithium interaction. There is no interaction there. Just use them at the levels and doses that are most appropriate. How do we do an early morning urine osmolality if they're an outpatient on tele? Will Quest give them the cup? Absolutely they will. You know how they'll give them the cup? Because you'll put in the order. So you'll put in the order for early morning urine osmolality. And maybe if you can actually talk to a human being at the lab, if maybe you can give them a few cups. Yeah, we're going to do this a bunch of times. Can you give them like four or five? So that way you can minimize. But at some point, they're going to have to drop it off anyhow, so they can always just pick up another cup then. But that's what you do. Again, it's urine osmolality. Not blood osmolality, not 24-hour urine collection. I mean, if you want to do it, it's the gold standard. Anyone here ever save their urine in a jug? Okay. Anyone ever do it multiple times? Yeah, not too often. One guy did. Right. Pain in the neck? Absolutely. Did you make a mistake once in a while? Once in a while it happens. Oh, you get up 2 in the morning, as you did this morning, hungover, stagger to the bathroom. Oh, I forgot to pee in the jug. That's what happens. People just won't do it repeatedly. So that's why the EMUO. It's not the gold standard, but it's an excellent surrogate. If nocturia is an issue, is it worth switching to QAM dosing? No. Why are they having nocturia? Because they have polyuria. What are you going to do then? You're going to get an EMUO, and you're going to treat their problem. That's why they're peeing in that. And of course, you should educate them in case they just have zero common sense. You might want to not drink as many fluids in the afternoon and evening. I know. You'd think they would know this, but some people don't. Can polyuria cause a low urine creatinine? Yes, it can, because they're getting dilute urine. Again, I don't care about their urine creatinine. I don't track urine creatinines. I track GFR, which is based on a blood test, which used to only measure creatinine. But now the new formula, which came out a couple years ago, it scrapped the ridiculous race coefficient, and they use creatinine and also cystatin C. Does anyone have a lab which does a formula with cystatin C now? That'll be the future if it's not already happening soon enough. It's a much better formula. I don't care about anyone's heritage. It was a bad thing to begin with. We don't need that anymore, and that's the new formula. Next. Is EMUO only in the center? Well, EMUO literally means early morning urine osmolality. It's just an abbreviation for what we're actually measuring. would we only use it in the setting of polyuria? It's the only reason to use it. The only reason I can think of to use it. I will say this. Let's say at the beginning of lithium therapy, like, oh, I got this gal, she's 54 years old, she's hypertensive, I'm worried she may have some albuminuria and I can't get a hold of the PCP. I would say check the urine albumin to creatinine ratio. That's the lab you check. It's called the albumin to creatinine ratio, or the ACR, and it's best done on an EMUO. So if you're going to check albumin and you don't need to worry about urine concentration, you would do it, the albumin to creatinine ratio, on an EMUO. It's considered most reliable. And then the question is, how often do you do it? Well, if the patient's asymptomatic, I have in the table, it may be every 6 months. But of course, you're going to do that thing which you dread, but which I'm going to strong arm you into doing, which is talking to your patient. Jeez. All right. And once they say they have a problem, you're going to measure it, and you're going to start treating it. And then you're going to be measuring it periodically, because I'll put you on a Milliride. I'll give you 6 weeks for it to do its thing. I'll recheck your EMUO. If I up your dose, you know what I'm going to do again in 6 weeks? Check it again. And eventually, hopefully, you'll get it to where it needs to be, and then maybe you'll go back to less frequent monitoring. Is polyuria a symptom or a sign? Well, polyuria is the complaint of too much urine, but the clinical definition is putting out more than 3 liters, okay? Your patient will just say, I'm peeing too much, or maybe they'll say, I'm drinking too much. Now, if they put out 2.9 liters, do they have polyuria by the clinical definition? No. Are they happy with this? No. And that's why I don't get too hung up on whether they meet the threshold of 3 liters or not. If your patient's complaining, what's going to happen? They're going to tell you to take that lithium and find something else. Right. They might say other things too. So that's a big part of it. People don't like side effects such as polyuria. You have to ask them about it so you can get on top of it right away, not at the point where they're fed up and they say, I don't want to take this. And then you're like, wow, this might be a tough choice about what other things. When is it classified as nephrogenic diabetes insipidus? So nephrogenic means that's the cause of it. There are people who actually have central diabetes insipidus because they're not making the hormone vasopressin. But nephrogenic is what we're causing. We know it's a renal problem. On the EMUO, usually when it's below 300, we would call that full nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. When it's in that middle range, like 300 to 600, that's partial. I said normal was 850 and above. Maybe there's a little wiggle room there. Once you're getting to 600 to 300, it ain't normal. And below 300, it's full nephrogenic diabetes insipidus. How often should we monitor the patient's urine? Well, the only thing to monitor is EMUO for everybody. Periodically. Once they complain, you'll monitor more often, especially as you treat it. If they have comorbidities, you might get an albumin to creatinine ratio, but that's it. We don't dipstick people. Dipstick is kind of useless for this purpose anyhow. If you wanted to monitor protein, you get what's called the albumin to creatinine ratio, best done on an early morning specimen. Okay? So is ENaC kidney protective? Okay, I'm not sure what language it was written in, but I think I understand it. So, ENaC is just the ion channel whose normal physiologic function is to emit sodium, right? That's the way it was designed. It's just unfortunate that the ENaC in kidneys emits readily lithium more than sodium, 1.6 times more. It's just our bad luck, that's the way it is. But, as I mentioned, we have a solution for the problem. Now you know. Amiloride, the ENaC inhibitor. Is that protective in patients taking lithium? I don't think the field is at that stage just yet. I think maybe within my lifetime as a provider, it might be. Because someone is going to do the study showing that if we put people on Amiloride from day one, maybe I can mitigate all these problems. I think in this day and age, though, the best thing to do, again, is just talk to your patients every visit. You start peeing more, let me know. It may never happen. It may happen in the first month. But you want to know right away. You can start measuring it, and you can start doing something about it. Have researchers identified people with dysfunctional ENaCs by testing individuals who have been on lithium? So we don't fully understand. It's a great question, because you think, why do some people get polyuria and some people don't? We don't fully understand. Is it possible there's some structural differences in human beings in their ENaC? It is possible. ENaC is a structure formed of three proteins, alpha, beta, gamma, or delta. All ENaCs contain beta and gamma. That is just for trafficking the protein to the plasma membrane. The pore-forming unit for the ones in the kidney are alpha, and it's the alpha form which more readily emits lithium. Those ENaCs which have the delta form actually emit lithium less than sodium. It's too bad that wasn't in the kidney, right? I'll tell the lady upstairs, when you design kidneys, can you swap the ENaCs? But that being said, that's probably true. But independent of dosing and all those things, it's clear there's probably differences that may relate to this, or maybe they're more effective in clearing lithium out of that basement membrane through that other channel, which is a sodium hydrogen exchanger. We don't fully understand, but it's clear not everybody has a problem. The only way you know is to ask. Does amiloride help with psychogenic polydipsia? No, it doesn't. So psychogenic polydipsia is driven typically by what? Uncontrolled schizophrenia. You know what drug works well for psychogenic polydipsia? Clozapine, yeah, how about that? Not a clozapine lecture, but it's good I could work it in. These people are usually treatment resistant, and that's why they have psychogenic polydipsia. The only drug which has been proven to work in these people is clozapine. So these are people who typically need clozapine. What if labs are normal, people have severe tremors? How do you manage the lithium? Again, if somebody has severe tremor, it means they have high brain levels for them. If it's severe, almost certainly, my first response is, number one, I'm going to lower the level some, because what I'm thinking is they're just getting much higher level. Even if the peripheral level is not that bad, so well, it's 0.8, their brain, it's too much. Their brain to serum ratio might be higher than 0.5, higher than the next person. And then the drug of choice for lithium-related tremors is propranolol. Propranolol gets into the CNS. It's the same drug that we use for essential tremor. But make sure you keep titrating it, okay? Don't put somebody on 10 BID and say, oh, it doesn't work. Yeah, no kidding. They're not 8 years old. Keep going up. Once you get to propranolol with the 60 milligram dose, there's an extended release form which they can take once a day. Keep titrating it. Hopefully they'll tolerate it, but you're also probably, if it's that bad, going to have to shave down their lithium, but that's probably the appropriate response. Well, the patient currently has polydipsia, but not polyuria yet. Well, the question is, how would you know that they don't have polyuria? Sometimes people don't fully estimate how much they're peeing, or they don't really notice the degree to which it's a problem. So I would say, if they're telling you, compared to my pre-lithium baseline, I'm drinking more, your first response will be, here's the cup, let's measure it, do a 24-hour food intake record, and then we can address the problem. That's the last question. Thank you all very much. I appreciate it.